Adha, can you hear me now? Saravan sir, welcome sir.
Hi sir, good evening sir. Welcome,
good evening,
sir.
Nice sir. We have Dr. Vijay there from Pune on the other side. Adha, can you hear me now? Adha, can you hear me? Welcome sir, welcome sir. Welcome,
sir. Good evening, sir. Good evening, sir.
Nice sir. Saravan sir, I'm just playing that video given by Dr. Shivashankar. He'll also come there to join with us.
Hello everybody, I welcome all of you for today's journal club on distal radius fractures. This is an academic event initiated and organized by the Journal of Hand and Microsurgery under the aegis of Indian Orthopaedics Association or the IOA. I am the president elect as well. Also, along with OASIS, the Association of Orthopaedic Surgeons of South Indian States, along with the president elect of the Tamil Nadu Orthopaedic Association, and the Association of Orthopaedic Surgeons of South Indian States, City Club in South India. come. It's a great academic event, and I wish all the very best for this today's webinar as well as for the future webinars. It's a great friends, and extremely glad that one of the top persons in the field of risk and upper limb surgery, that is none other than Dr. Jesse Jupiter, the past president of for the hands in America, as well as for the elbow and shoulder association, that is one of the main faculty. The past is here with us today, along with other people like Professor Neal C Chen is from Boston University. We also have from South America, that is from Argentina, Dr. Jorge Boretto Dorsal. It's also from Asia, that is from Malaysia, South America. We have Amir Adham, all experts in this field. With such a wonderful galaxy of faculty, this activity is about to cross the expectations of all the organizers. I'm glad that it has already crossed over 500 initiations, and they had to stop the initiations quite a long time back because of the great response the organizers have got in this webinar organized. I'm also glad that we have delegates from across the globe, from so many countries attending this meet. Friends, those who are unable to attend this live on this Zoom meeting, definitely you will be able to see the proceedings of this meeting on other channels like YouTube. I welcome all the people who are watching this webinar. I wish this academic event, which is recurring, all the very best in future. Thank you very much. Hello, everybody.
Welcome, welcome, Hamada.
Hi.
How are you?
Nice to meet you.
Yeah, nice to meet you after a long time.
Yes. I have a little bit cold. Not coronavirus, but sorry, I'm on the bed.
Okay, no problem. So all well in Japan?
Yes.
So my greetings.
A little bit.
Yeah, my greetings to Professor Minamikawa.
Yeah, like this. On the bed, sorry.
What
So I put off the video. Maybe that's better. So okay, I see.
Okay, I understand. Yeah, good. Very good. Thanks for coming despite this problem. Yeah. You know,
thank you.
I appreciate
with
that.
With pleasure.
Yeah, it's nice to see you. Saravanan sir. When you are ready, sir, we just have some memento, online memento, to be given to our faculties. Just whenever you just speak, I'll let share the screen. Dr. Shivashankar will join. So he will share an online memento. These online memento, I'll just share with you. If you can see this. Thank you. I'm sending you as a panelist. That's a panelist. Just go inside. I'll just link. I'm just. I was resending it to you. Was my recent aaya na sent. Hold on. Jay, email hota na, VIJAY. It is not coming. Kata, you already added this person as a panelist. I cannot send it. You already added this invitation. Just go to your previous email and try again. Go to email and try again.
Again, yeah?
You try again.
Try again.
Yeah. So listen, Suno. Can you see this FaceTime? It's not coming. I'll try sending you again. So you register and come inside. I'll make you a panelist. Okay. No, you register as a registrant and then come. I'll make you as a panelist.
Okay.
Hello.
Yep.
Yes. Can you hear me? Okay.
Yeah. Welcome, Dr. Jesse.
Hi. Hi.
Yeah. How are you?
Very well, thanks.
Yeah. Thank you for making us privileged to have you today.
Okay. Well, it's a good time for us.
Yeah. We have almost more than 500 registrars from different countries.
Right, and right. I've heard from some already.
Yeah, they're very eager to talk, listen to your talk across the world. I mean, many country people are there registered.
Yeah. It's actually a great thing.
Yeah.
Meet again with friends and don't have to leave your home.
Very nice. I'll just give you a brief about the program. We'll start exactly at 9 a.m. of Eastern time, that is 7:30 p.m. of Indian time. We'll have a 1-minute introduction by the president of the Indian Orthopaedic Association, 1-minute introduction by the State Orthopaedic Association, and then I will introduce these four speakers in 1 minute.
Okay.
Then you will talk for 15 minutes. Subsequently, all the four speakers will talk 15 minutes. So together, 1 hour.
Right.
The question and answers will be dealt at the end.
Okay.
We will try to keep as short and brief as possible so that we will all, stick to the time and we'll have a lot of questions and interactions.
Okay, sounds good.
I hope I am clear about the proceedings.
It'll work out.
So we have eight more time, eight minutes to start. So you can, if you want, you can check your presentations whether working or not, so that you know we can make you as a co-host.
Okay, let me try here. Now the host, let's see, okay, that works.
Fine, perfect. Welcome, Dr. Anil Bhatt.
Hi.
We have a few panelists in this program. They are all from our Indian Society of Hand Surgery, who are into distal radius and other wrist fractures. So they will be the best person to have, you know, with the panel. And we'll be joined with three more speakers, which are supposed to come. Yeah, Anil, welcome, Amir, Dr. Amir from Malaysia. Yeah, welcome.
Okay.
Hi, Dr. Terrence. Hi, everyone.
Yeah, hi. So,
Terrence, you have a combined nationality name.
Yeah. Yeah, actually, you know, I was, you know, it was just a start to have a program for our journal. The moment we thought the first fascinating topic was your topic, distal radius. Okay. And then I could, get good people on the board. The moment I got you, then it's very easy for me to get the other speakers for me, like Dr. Neal Chen, whom I personally knew because I was there for some time in Mass General Hospital as an American international traveling fellow. So
okay.
Yeah, he was a very nice surgeon who, you know, I had the pleasure of, you know, watching him operating over 66 in the hockey building. So
yeah,
it's nice. And Jorge Boretto from Argentina, I know him very personal. He's a very close friend of mine. So there are very good surgeons who can really contribute on this topic, even though one of the favorite topic for many of surgeons. I thought we'll start with this topic. We have our president here, President-elect Dr. B. Shivashankar of the Indian Orthopaedic Association.
Okay.
Welcome, Dr. Shivashankar.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Nice to see you.
We have five more minutes. Dr. Amir, you want to check your presentation or is it okay for you?
I'm okay. Can we check?
Yeah, I make you a co-host. You can do that.
Okay. Can you see this?
Yep.
Yes.
All right. Okay.
Thank you.
Awesome. All right. I'm ready.
Perfect. Yeah, Dr. Amir, you can close, you can stop sharing your screen.
I'm not sure how. Let me. How do I do this?
You should say stop sharing on top.
Stop sharing on top. Ah, yes. Thank you so much, Dr. Jesse. Yeah.
You know, Amir was very, you know, surprised to see you on the board.
When oh, yes.
Very much surprised.
Good.
I said
we were like a legend in. When I was studying distal radius, all the journals are all about all your name is there, Dr. Jesse Jupiter, everything is there. So yeah, it's an honor for me to finally meet you, Dr. Jesse.
Yes, we meet over a electronic method.
Yeah, is good enough for me, sir.
Sure thing. Yeah.
Good evening, Bhatt sir.
Yeah, we have Professor Bhatt. Professor Bhatt is there. He's also like more into carpal fractures and distal radius fractures, and he's very interested and keen and you know having to this topic. He has been doing wonderful you know surgery, especially in our country India. He's the professor and the associate dean. It's a great honor to have him also like to share this knowledge and also to have a common you know understanding about distal radius fractures. We expect around 500 participants through the registration, and beyond that it is also shared through YouTube and Facebook. So we might get some questions and queries during the talk. We are waiting for Neal Chen and Boretto from Argentina.
Yes, Neal Chen has joined.
Yeah, welcome, Dr. Neal Chen.
Hi.
Morning. Nice to see you. Morning.
Nice to see you too.
Good evening. Good nice morning.
Good night. Midnight.
Good evening. Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Hi. Hello.
Welcome, Tahir.
Hello.
Yeah, thank you. Welcome, Tahir. Welcome, Ramesh.
Yes, welcome. Good morning. Good evening.
Terrence, Hamada is also joining.
Yeah, Hamada is there from Japan.
Yes.
Welcome, Hamada.
Thank you. As you can see, I'm on the bed. I may have a cold. So I just watch and enjoy and study. Thank you.
great. You are asked very simple, very, very kind.
It will soon.
We are yet to get a response from Boretto. If he could join, and probably we can start the session.
Good evening, Anil sir. Good evening, Saravanan.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Yes.
Seeing back again.
Yeah, correct. Even Tahir. So we have been together so many times. Yeah.
Yeah.
Welcome, Dr. Thirumalai Swami. He's the president of our State Orthopaedic Association. He's there. Sir, welcome.
Yeah, Terrence. Hi.
Hi, sir.
Good evening, TMS.
Hello, sir.
Sir, your favorite, the pioneer Dr. Jesse is here.
Yeah.
Oh, is he? I can't see in the screen, but anyway.
He is there as a panelist. I mean, you can see him.
Right.
Increase the number of panelists to gallery mode, in the gallery mode. Then you can see all of them.
All right. Okay. Participants.
In mobile, you can see only four. If you are on the mobile, then don't forget about that.
Yeah, I'm opening the laptop here.
Yeah. By the portrait picture of yours itself, I could guess that you are on a portable device like mobile.
Okay.
We are all in landscape mode.
All right. Okay. In a minute, yeah. I think I'll go out and come back in that.
Yeah, that will be better.
Dr. Neal,
start echoing two instruments from one place.
Dr. Neal Chen, I made you as a co-host. If you want to check your presentation, you can just check that, whether your pictures or videos are working.
Okay. So I'm going to share my screen really quickly then.
Yeah.
All right. Give me 2 seconds. Can everybody see this?
Yeah, perfect.
Okay.
Great.
So yeah. I'll stop sharing. Great.
Thank you. Welcome, Dr. Anirban.
Hi.
Yeah, nice to see you.
Hello, everyone on the panel. Good to be here.
Today is the auspicious day in our country. We celebrate this festival of light, Deepam, Kartikeya Deepam. So, great occasion that we started this program on auspicious day. Can we start? We are yet to receive a reply from Boretto from Argentina. Probably he will join in between.
I think, Terrence, we should start. It's already 5 minutes late, and then
you're right.
Join in. Yeah.
You're perfect. So good evening, good morning, welcome to this first initiative of Journal of Hand and Microsurgery, the Association of Indian Orthopaedic Association, Orthopaedic Association of South Indian States, Tamil Nadu Orthopaedic Association, and Tiruchy Ortho Club had made an initiative to have a monthly series of journal club. To start with, we have chosen the topic of distal radius fracture. It's always really, you know, fascinating for every orthopedic surgeons, especially hand surgeons, to deal with. With this brief introduction, I'll welcome all the faculties, the pioneer of the hand surgery and also one of the well-renowned hand surgeon across the world, Dr. Jesse Jupiter, Dr. Neal Chen, whom I know him very close when I was there for a short period of traveling fellowship. He's a nice gentleman, very good surgeon. Dr. Amir Adham, who's a young and enthusiastic valiant surgeon for all upper limb surgeries. And Boretto is supposed to join us. He's a very fascinating and wonderful surgeon. You ask him anything, he says yes. Such a wonderful and a helpful person for me in all my endeavors. Welcome, Boretto. With this brief introduction, the program goes such a way, we have a formal introduction by our Vice President-elect, Dr. B. Shivashankar, who is there with us. A few words from our President of Tamil Nadu Orthopaedic Association, Dr. Thirumalai Swami. And then we'll directly go to the first talk with Dr. Jesse, followed by Dr. Neal Chen, Dr. Boretto, and then Dr. Amir, who is supposed to be the last person who can mesmerize us with Valant. I request Dr. Shoshankar to start this wonderful initiative and then give a few words.
Thank you, Jerome. At the outset, I would like to welcome all the people who are on the panel now, especially Dr. Jesse Jupiter, Dr. Neal Chen, Dr. Boretto, Dr. Amir Ahmad, all of them for this wonderful webinar initiated by Hand Surgery Editor, along with Indian Orthopaedic Association, Association of Orthopaedic Surgeons of South Indian States, Tamil Nadu Orthopaedic Association, and Tiruchy Orthopaedic Club. I'm very glad that this is a monthly activity which they have started on this auspicious occasion of a full moon day. As you said, it's a month of light in India. We all celebrate with Deepavali, the whole month, Kartik month, we celebrate. And on the midst of this, on the day of full moon, we have got this initiative started by our own person, and I congratulate them. I welcome all of you for this wonderful meet. Wish you all the very best.
Thank you, Dr. Shoshankar. Dr. Thirumala Swami. Okay, we will go ahead with the first talk by Dr. Jesse Jupiter.
Okay, well, thank you, Dr. Jerome and Terrence, and I'm glad this is a very important beginning of what should be a great a monthly program, and particularly reaching out all throughout Asia and Asia Pacific. Let me see if I can shed some light, given the Festival of Light, on what I think are some problem fractures at the distal radius. Since we're all treating most of these surgically that are intra-articular and are displaced, the trend has gone, as you know, toward a volar approach and a volar fixation. The question is in some cases, the reduction of the anterior or volar component is generally straightforward, but how do we approach the dorsal lunate facet and without making a second dorsal incision? And that's what I'd like to do to start out with. We'll look at how do we assess the relationship of the dorsal lunate facet and its particular alignment. Look at some of the issues from anterior fixation. Is there any new technology that helps, and the adjuvant use of a compression clamp? If you look at many of the outcome studies, rarely are we looking at the postoperative view of the reduction. And as you know, it's generally very difficult to tell without an oblique view or certainly a CT scan. But there are a number of ways that have been published to give a definition as to the alignment and the both in the coronal and sagittal projection, as well as the relationship of the ulnar head to the sigmoid notch. And bear in mind that an injury that involves the lunate facet of the distal radius is not only involving the articular surface of the distal radius, but also the articular surface of the sigmoid notch and distal radial ulnar joint. Not too long ago, a multi-center study tried to look at the characterization of the dorsal ulnar corner using CT and then three-dimensional recreation of the fracture. And this just gives you an impression that the fragments are not always the same size or shape, and may be more difficult in some cases to fix through an anatomically shaped plate. If we look at this and ask the question, what's the ideal screw length in stabilizing a distal radius fracture from the volar approach? And what's the ideal plate position? Can we do both of these without putting our plate too distal in a position that may injure flexor tendons? For a long time, many people have believed that for an extra-articular fracture, for sure, you don't have to grab the opposite cortex. In fact, these are not functioning as screws, but they're really as fixed angle devices. And so if you have at least 3/4 of the surface of the end of the metaphysis, that should be sufficient. And with the extra-articular fractures, it's really not as much a problem. And we can put the anatomically shaped plate in a very anatomic position and avoid some of the problems of screws. But there have been several studies that have looked at what happens and how to measure where the plate is. And keep this in mind, because when you assess your fixation, you want to look at the relationship of the plate to the volar cortex of the radius and how the end of the plate sits in relationship to that. And secondly, can we keep our plate in a safe position and then still get some purchase in the dorsal lunate facet? So we know that this works very well for extra articular fractures, but can we do the same with a dorsal ulna corner displacement? So if we look at this, and the only way, to be honest, that you can really assess postoperatively is with a CT scan. And we've done that in a number of studies to look at this particular issue. So here you see where the plate is, it's pretty distal, and with a fixed angle device, this is where the screw will go. We can drop the plate back, but we may not have the flexibility of positioning the screws. But with a variable angle type device, we can avoid that problem. And here's the plate in a more anatomic position and in a better position for getting some purchase of the device. So if we have a plate that's too distal, we stand the risk of causing flexor tendon injury. And therefore, ideally, we want to keep our plate more proximally, yet still try to get some purchase in that facet. As illustrated in this case, and if you look at the post-op coronal CT scan, you see that we've gone to but not through the dorsal cortex with a good functional result. Now, as we have looked at these in three-dimensional projection preoperatively, we've come to appreciate, as that multi-center study did, that there are multiple shapes. And therefore, it may be difficult to grab these with your implant, but the best option is to avoid keeping the plate too distal, as illustrated in these pictures on your left. Again, the protruding plate is something that may be difficult with fixed angle because it may also put the screw into the joint. And we'd rather have the plate more proximally, and if we have variable angle technology, we can accommodate that, as illustrated in this clinical case. Here's another clinical case. So I don't know the answer as to the ideal screw length in an extra-articular fracture, but if a large dorsal cortical component exists and is displaced, more purchase in that is better and more predictable. Now, there are some new technologies that have incorporated a way to incorporate a dorsal small percutaneous positioning of a screw into the recess hole of the volar cortex. I've not used this and don't have experience with it, but some people have published on this and it may be satisfactory. Bear in mind that the cortex of the dorsal lunate facet is very thin, so you have to have at least one washer to prevent it from going into the bone. But this is from their study showing a very nice a reposition and fixation. Now, there are a number of ways otherwise to do this, and let's look at the use of a compression clamp, because by getting the volar plate in position and then having an aid to help reduce that dorsal facet, we may be able to avoid making a second incision dorsally. So this was a prospective study looking at 61 consecutive patients, all treated in Uruguay and evaluated by our service as well. A standard volar approach, standard manipulation of the fracture on the volar side, applying the plate in an anatomically safe position, but then using a reduction clamp to aid in compressing the dorsal lunate facet component. One of the advantages of this clamp is that we don't have to keep the wrist in a bent position when we're reducing the fracture. We can keep it in a more neutral position, apply the plate, fix the plate proximally, and then use this clamp, which is a ball tip clamp with the green illustrated component is radio opaque plastic. And it sits on the dorsal surface over and wraps around the ulnar head. And the idea being that by compressing, we can bring the fracture fragments together a little bit more reliably and then apply our screws in a fixed position, in a safe position. Here's a case. And one thing that the clamp also can do is help reduce the volar tilt. So if we look here, we have the volar side is fairly readily reduced because it's often not comminuted. And now we've reduced it, and here's your reduction through a standard volar approach. And now the plate has been applied, held in place by one screw and one clamp. And then this is the ball tip clamp that was used to compress the fracture. Here you see it before compression. And notice by squeezing down on the dorsal surface, we're able to improve the volar tilt. And here's that patient postoperatively. So in this study, we used the pre-op and early post-op axial and sagittal CT scans and looked at this. And if you look toward your left, the pre-op data on this one patient and the post-op data, I think you can appreciate the realignment of both the coronal and sagittal views of the sigmoid notch and the ulnar head. Here's another patient with a displacement and the reduction. And here's yet another patient in the study with both sigmoid notch displacement, dorsal lunate facet displacement, and in a sagittal view, you can see the amount of dorsal angulation of the metaphyseal component. And this is the post-op CT scan. Notice the screw will go up to, but not through the cortex. And if you look at that case from pre-op to post-op, the improvement is substantial. We now look at the studies of the average age and type of fracture and the objective and subjective evaluation. And let me say that this is a good study because it shows the alignment post-operatively and gives you an idea of the clamp that impact on the reduction. So I think that that's something that it's the supplier of this is Dupuis Synthes, and it's a useful device to have when you have complex articular fractures. So with that, my 15 minutes is up, and I think we'll turn it over to Dr. Chen.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you very much, Jesse. That was a wonderful talk. It was nice to hear from directly from you, though on a digital platform. These moments I'll cherish for a long time because I wanted to meet you, see you. Thanks to Terrence, Jose, Jerome for giving this opportunity for me. I request on behalf of the whole team to give a memento, a virtual memento too. It's a drawing of yours. I request Terrence to hand over that memento to you, please.
Hey, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. this was a picture that we drew, one of our...
That's great. Yeah. At least I have hair.
Yeah. So we will send this caricature with properly made with wood and to your address, and also you send through your email so that you can have an email. Thanks.
Okay, thank you.
Great. Well, let me extend my thanks again to Terrence for inviting me. Let me share my screen with you to start. Okay. So just some disclosures to start with. And where I wanted to begin was to take one step back and give us a sense of what do we understand? And then I think we can start coming back to where Dr. Jupiter has brought us in terms of the importance of paying attention to these anatomic factors. This is the data, and I wanted to start off with this picture because the data is cloudy. And the ways we can see and understand our outcomes of distal radius fractures really is through this lens. And I think that if we begin with our understanding that we don't see that well, I think that's a good place to start. We know that fractures are heterogeneous. We know from our own clinical experience that a subset of fractures do well regardless of the intervention, and a subset do well with some type of intervention. But our outcome measures are quite crude, and we know that they're altered and impacted by overall health, society, and psychology. When we start looking at the data and then looking at the highest quality studies that we have available, we can see that the data is conflicting. When we looked at volar locked plating versus non-operative treatment, we have two conflicting studies. One that says there's no difference in the DASH, PRWE, whereas another study shows that those outcomes are superior in volar locked plating. When we look at comparisons to external fixation, we see that outcomes are similar long-term, but volar plating has a faster recovery as we would expect intuitively. And then when we compare volar plating versus CRPP, we continue to see some of these problems. We see that the outcomes are relatively similar at 5 years, but we do see some signal in the data that grip strength and radiographic parameters are superior in locked plating. And we see that same trend in the comparisons between volar locked plating and non-operative treatment. So in our interpretation of this data, we can see that outcome measures are crude and they're affected by psychosocial factors. Kevin Chung did a very large trial in multiple centers across the United States And what did he see? He saw education was really the major determinant of outcomes, and the treatment type and the radiographic parameters weren't associated with it. So how do we interpret this? And this gets challenging. And I think that we have to interpret it as, okay, our ways of looking at this are limited, but there's a signal that we can see that anatomic parameters appear to make a difference. And so as we begin to think about this and try to put this information into a context, we can say ulna positivity, disorders of the radiocarpal axis, large articular step-offs, all of those are meaningful and impact outcomes at some level, but not at this large, broad level that we're seeing with a DASH or with a PRWE or a Michigan Hand questionnaire. So if you're going to operate on a distal radius fracture, your goals are to restore radiographic parameters as best as possible. And this gets us back to where Dr. Jupiter was at our prior presentation, is that there's value to anatomic reduction. So building on the concepts that Dr. Jupiter has given us, I'm going to introduce a couple other concepts here. And some of the evolving concepts are about carpal instability and articular malalignment and radioulnar convergence. Some of the problems with articular step-off, Dr. Jupiter had this seminal paper looking at articular step-off and the effects of it. And he observed that a step-off of 2 millimeters was associated with arthrosis. But a more important and more valuable takeaway point was in further papers that he had written in clarification of this, in that all patients in the series developed some level of radiographic arthrosis. And that's an important takeaway point. The 2 millimeter cutoff was just the cutoff to reach that statistical threshold, but all those patients were having changes. And when you look at the papers that have followed subsequently, especially by Catalano and Goldfarb, you can see this arthrosis progressing over the course of the next couple decades. You see that at 7 years, at 15 years, this arthrosis is progressing, and you see some of the consequences of those earlier malreductions. So our understanding is that this step-off has a relationship, but it may take a while to manifest clinically in most of the cases. So when we look back, when we say our outcome measures, we have this focus on DASH, on PROMIS, on PRWE. These instruments, and this is work that was done by David Ring and Dr. Jupiter as well, is that those instruments are overwhelmed by depression, they're overwhelmed by anxiety. As Kevin Chung was demonstrating, they're overwhelmed by education. But that central question of does quality of surgery matter, does reduction of surgery matter, it does matter. And it's just that our instruments are crude, I can't see it. So here we're at our point, can we improve reductions? When we look at the clamp that Dr. Jupiter's shown, that's one technological improvement. There's other advancements that are happening as well. There's new locking technologies. Current locking plate technologies involve cross-threading of your screws. Cross-threading of your screws into the plate. And you can cross-thread the screws into the plate a couple times, but then you lose the locking capability. And this is variable angle technology is a really major improvement, because it allows you to place your plate different locations and still get angles that allow you to capture different fragments. But there are new technologies that are similar to pedicle screws being applied to distal radius as well. And so when you use these technologies, you can improve your reductions. This is an example of using a joystick technique. So you've applied your plate proximally, and let's say that you've secured your radial styloid in the position that you want it, but you see that the ulnar corner, the ulnar portion of the fracture isn't ideal. You can lever this using your compression screw and then lock it, hold it in place with a K-wire, and then lock it in place with the locking cap. So there are new ways of doing this, and this is all coming down the pike. This is all, these developments are coming over time. And I would expect many manufacturers having similar technology soon. And our goals are to continue to improve that articular step off, continuing to improve the articular reduction. A second concept is the concept of radial ulnar convergence. And Scott Wolf and Trahan, as well as George Orbe, have really written a fair amount about this over the last 5 years. And you can see here on the picture on the left side, you can see that you have this convergence of the radius towards the ulna. And commonly this has been interpreted when you are doing these surgeries as well, my distal portion of the radius is translated radially. But in fact, it's that convergence of the radius to the ulna, the forearm bones are coming together, that is the actual pathology. And some of this is perceived as translation. Some of this is actually perceived as loss of height. So one of the takeaway points that Trahan has really given us is this idea of trying to reduce that or trying to fix that convergence. And the reasons why are that portion of the interosseous ligament is at the wrong tension when those two bones converge. And when you restore that alignment, you can restore that form relationship and improve the mechanics of the forearm. So I want to go over a sample case here, and we can also discuss some of the applications of newer technology here as well. This is an interarticular distal radius fracture that's dorsally displaced. You can see that the radiocarpal axis is disordered. You can see that this is likely to improve with an operative intervention. We can look at the CT scan. We can see this. There's some articular displacement. You can see some disorders of the radiocarpal axis. And on this view, you can see that part of the joint is impacted inside the shaft. So there are different ways of approaching this problem. You can apply the plate proximally first, applying the plate to the shaft, and then bring the fragments to the plate. Another way of approaching this is distal first, applying the plate distal to the distal fragment, and then reducing it to the distal fragment, and then bringing the shaft to it distally. I think when Terrence was visiting, we had done a case using this distal first approach. And so in this distal first approach, there are some advantages. And using all these other concepts, let's bring them together and apply them. So you apply the plate distally, you're trying to match it to that articular surface on the ulnar side. And then these compression screws can pull together the fragment. And by pulling together a fragment, you can capture the rotation, lock the rotation. Secondly, you can try to address the interarticular malalignment by using K-wires to rotate your radial fragments to bring them to the ulnar fragment. So you're trying to minimize your articular step off, to minimize the articular pathology. And then again, by placing the screws into that radial styloid fragment and locking the screws in place, you can get more controlled capture. Then using this method that Dr. Jupiter described long ago, is that you can basically lever the plate back onto the shaft. And then from here, you can address your radial ulnar convergence. And you can see that there's a screw hole that allows for moving the plate, moving the shaft relative to the plate. And by using the laminar spreader, you can reduce and you can improve your reduction. So I'll show this in, again, these are our steps, fixing the ulnar corner distally with compression screws, the locking caps, reducing the radial styloid to that fragment, and then reducing the entire distal fragment to the shaft. Here's another case example. Here, I'm capturing that ulnar corner. I'm only paying attention to the ulnar corner. I'm ignoring everything else. And then once I have the ulnar corner, I use this K-wire to joystick the radial styloid into position. And then from here, I then take that construct, apply it to the shaft by clamping this down. The locking mechanism is very strong in this situation, in this construct. And so you're not as worried about pulling out the plate, pulling the plate off the distal fragments. Here, we place the screw in this spinning hole, this oval hole that rotates, and then we're correcting the radial ulnar convergence. And then once that's done, we place some locking screws proximally. So those are the many different, there's many different techniques of treating distal radius fractures. And it's the evolution of these techniques to try to improve our anatomic reduction. I think that this is continuing to be an evolution. Now the complications, a couple complications to be aware of, and I believe that are critical to be thoughtful about. The first is the volar lunate facet, and the second is the watershed line. Volar lunate facet, this is a problem that Dr. Jupiter described along with Diego Fernandez, Keith Raskin, and Neil Harness. You can see that there was this loss of fixation of volar lunate facet fragments in the setting of volar plating of distal radius fractures. And so when you're looking at these fractures, you have to pay attention to the size of that fragment and be aware that if you're not capturing that fragment, the fracture can jump the plate, the carpus can jump the plate. And so when you're looking at these different problems, know your options, know that you can capture it with a plate. Sometimes you might have to put the plate a little bit more distally to capture it. You have to know options of different pin plates, pins that you can capture it. There's many different additions to plates now to try to avoid this complication. And then the third option is tension banding. This is another technique that was described by Dr. Jupiter as well. So this is the fragment specific plating. You can see that there's little paper clips that are held down to plates. This can help capture those fragments. And then here's another case. You can see on the CT scan, there is a very, very small volar lunate facet fragment. And any way of capturing that with the plate is very difficult. You can't even capture it with those pins. So what do? You can do is tension band. You place two holes in the radial shaft proximally, place a free needle with a 25 gauge wire on the needle and use that to pass it through those shaft holes, and then pass this in a figure eight configuration to draw that fragment down and hold it and secure it. And you can see here in this X-fix and pins, you can see that construct working right here to secure that fragment, to hold that fragment in place. This is after it's healed. And so know all those different techniques. And then finally, there's this concept of this flexor tendon irritation with the watershed line. And we look at the margin of the distal radius. There's a level that you have to be respectful of when you see this plate application. And once you pass that watershed line, you may be beginning to irritate the flexor pollicis longus. And a general rule of thumb is that that distal border of the peroneal quadratus, to avoid placement of your plate distal to that. But this was originally described occurring in one plate, but there's many plates where this this problem occurs. And I think the most important takeaway point is actually to be very mindful of this crepitus after in late follow-up. We looked at our own series of flexor tendon, flexor pollicis longus ruptures requiring reconstruction at MGH and Brigham and Women's Hospital in our larger system. And the important point that we saw was this was, all of those ruptures were occurring in patients with SUM grade 1 plate placements. So these were proximal plate placements, but they were still getting FPL ruptures. So why was that happening? Well, we speculate that the plates that were placed more distally were being taken out. People were paying attention to crepitus. People were paying attention to the distal plate placement. But patients with the more proximal plate placements were still having problems with flexor tendon ruptures. So we're following our patients with distal radius volar plates very carefully to make sure that they are aware of crepitus, that we think about testing for this at 6 months, at 1 year after surgery, just to avoid this complication, because the outcomes of the FPL reconstructions are very inconsistent, and we want to minimize that complication. So in conclusion, long-term patient rate outcomes are overpowered by other factors. And if you understand that, it helps put some of this data into context. Short-term recovery is better in general with volar lock plating. Grip strength may be related to reduction of anatomic parameters and maybe a good surrogate for understanding the outcomes while we still are using these crude outcome measures. And finally, we've known this for a long time, but arthritis is related to intra-articular malreduction. So our takeaway points, there's a role for better anatomic reduction. If you're going to do the surgery, do it as well as you can. But do it and be aware of all these other pitfalls, including loss of fixation of volar nuchal facet. Be aware of FPL rupture. Thank you again for having me. And then I really enjoyed speaking to all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Neal Chen. I still remember that the Miami plate which I was there during your time, and you mentioned about the alignment on the ulnar aspect of the distal radius. That's more, you know, the critical, you know, putting the fixation. That's great. We have Dr. Thirumal Chami here, our Tamil Nadu State Orthopaedic Association President, to have a few words.
Hi. Thanks, Terrence, for the wonderful meeting on the focused distal radial fracture, which we all see commonly, but we have gained a lot during these two talks with the master, Dr. Jesse Jupiter, and very clear presentation by Dr. Neal Chen. Really, we are very thankful to both of you. And on behalf of the Tamil Nadu State Orthopaedic Association, we convey our regards to both of you, as well as all the panelists as well. Thank you very much. Kindly accept a small memento from us.
Thanks. That's great.
And that will be sent to you physically in due course of time. Thank you.
That's awesome. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll move on to the next speaker, Dr. Jorge Boretto.
Well, thank you so much, Terrence. I share my screen. Let me see if you see my screen.
Yeah, perfect.
Okay, perfect. Well, thank you so much for your kind invitation. It's a great pleasure to be with those with all the participants. And thank you. It's a pleasure for me. Well, I'm talking about dorsal plating for distal radius. And the goal of treatment in unstable distal radius fractures are to restore metaphyseal alignment as well as to avoid intra-articular incongruence. Unstable fractures require internal fixation to obtain these goals. However, there is no strong evidence that volar plating be better over dorsal plating. In late 90s, the dorsal approach and plate fixation gained popularity because of direct articular visualization and placement of internal fixation as a dorsal buttress, allowing adequately reconstruction of the articular surface. Although this later approach had several advantages, the rate of associated complication rapidly discredits the dorsal plating. In 2002, Orbay and Fernandez introduced the principle of volar fixation for dorsally displaced fracture with locking plates. Since then, volar approach has gained great acceptance, leading to a change in treatment over the years in favor of the volar plating. Volar locking plates have provided the capability to repair both simple and complex fracture while avoiding the hardware-related complications associated with dorsal plating, as you can see in this young man with an intra-articular distal radial fracture treated with a volar locking plate, and his functional result at 2 years follow-up. Nonetheless, the use of volar plates has been also associated with a substantial rate of complication. And this complication can be divided in those related to technical mistakes and those related to inability to fix or even to maintain the fixation of some fracture patterns. While the complication of the extensor and flexor tendon are associated mainly with technical mistakes, loss of reduction has been associated to the fracture pattern. In this paper, the author conclude that volar locking plate can be used for most of distal radius fracture, as we know. However, certain conic fracture type may be treated best by alternative means. With respect to dorsal plating, its indication have no follow any rational criteria. Most of the studies describe the treatment of articular fracture as a main indication for dorsal plating. However, articular fracture have many different patterns, and some fracture threats cannot be treated by volar or dorsal plating, contrary to what many authors have concluded. Lasky state that certain fracture patterns are more appropriately stabilized with dorsal plate fixation. They include dorsal shear fracture, type Barton type fracture, die punch fracture, or fracture patterns in which an indirect reduction from the volar approach cannot be obtained. Although the first two patterns are well defined, the third one is more vague. Even more, Lasky did not report the result of dorsal plating in this pattern since he described the indication in a technical article. In our hospital, we have defined the fracture pattern to treat by dorsal fixation after reviewing the first 60 cases of dorsal plating we did. After a critical analysis, we have defined that most fracture could have been treated by volar plate, but there were some fracture patterns that were amenable to treatment by dorsal approach. Those fracture patterns we defined to treat by dorsal plating were displaced central articular fragment, volar distal fracture, displaced dorsal ulnar fragment, dorsal partial fracture, or a combination of these patterns. Here you can see an X-ray and CT scan of the displaced central articular fragment. We have included also a pattern volar distal fracture, and we have quantified the minimal distance between the fracture and the radiocarpal joint in our cases with a mean of 4.7 millimeter. Our findings, of course, do not pertain to the volar ulnar fracture, as Dr. Chen showed us, which absolutely must be fixed by a volar approach, as Dr. Jupiter has learned us. Here you can see a displaced dorsal ulnar fragment, and in these figures you can see a dorsal partial fracture, which we define as amenable to fixation by dorsal approach. So this type of fracture pattern determines the indication for dorsal fixation of the distal radius in our institution, and we have recently reviewed the result of these cases. During a six-year period, 679 distal radius fracture were treated with open reduction and internal fixation in our institution. Of these, 32 patients underwent dorsal plating of the distal radius. 5 were excluded for different reasons, and the remaining 27 patients fulfilled the inclusion criteria. The mean age of the at the time of treatment was 55 years, and 63% of patients were women. X-ray and CT scan evaluation showed that all fractures had dorsal displacement, and all but 5 cases had a combination of the fracture pattern described before. According to the AO classification, one case of type A2 fracture, A were type B groups 1 or 2, and 18 were type C groups 1, 2, or 3. At the median follow-up of 34 months, the median score of the DASH questionnaire was 4, and the median score of the PRW E was 3. 26 patients have no pain at rest, and 15 patients have no pain during activities. The patient rate the function of their wrist with a median of 9 over 10 points. All the articular parameters were restored to normal values, as well as articular gaps and steps, and no patients suffered loss of reduction during the follow-up. However, 12 patients have plate removal at a median follow-up of 6 months. None of them had extensor tendon rupture. I will present two cases as examples. The first one is a 39 years old man with an intra-articular distal radius fracture. CT scan show a volar distal fracture of the radius and a displaced dorso-ulnar fracture. Open reduction and internal fixation with the dorsal plate was performed. At 6 months, the plate was removed, and at 3 year follow-up, he has good recovery in terms of function, pain, and subjective outcomes. The second one is a case about a 47 years old woman who suffered a distal radial, a distal ulnar fracture, again a dorsal ulnar fragment, and a volar distal fracture were observed on CT scan. In this case, a dorsal plating with a columnar technique was performed with no loss of reduction during the follow-up. And at 4 year follow-up, she had good functional recovery. In summary, indication for dorsal plating have no follow any rational criteria in the literature. Most of the studies describe the treatment of articular fracture as a main indication for dorsal plating. Although most of these injuries can be treated with volar locking plates, there are almost 5% of these fractures with a specific pattern that are amenable to treatment with dorsal fixation, with no case suffering a loss of reduction. These specific fractures are, once again, displaced central articular fragment, volar distal fracture, displaced dorsal ulnar fragment, dorsal partial fractures, or what is more common, a combination of this pattern. Thank you so much.
Thank you for such a nice presentation. And we have a memento for you. This will be given physically, Terrence. It's very nice.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Wow, it's amazing. Thank you so much.
And thank you for joining us. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you for your invitation.
Thank you. Thank you. Terrence, next speaker.
Dr. Anil.
It's a pleasure to invite Dr. Adham, who's from, he's a consultant orthopedic hand surgeon from Prince Court Medical Center from National University of Malaysia, KL. And he'll be speaking on his technique of WALANT for distal radius fracture fixation. Dr. Amir?
Yeah, thank you so much. Well, okay, let me share my screen. Okay, thank you very much, Terrence, for having me here. It's my pleasure to share our technique on WALANT for distal radius fracture. So for plating distal radius fracture fixation is usually done under general anesthesia or regional anesthesia with tourniquet. So for this, we normally need anesthetists to be around and also using a tourniquet to reduce the bleeding at the fracture site. So our problem previously when we started this in 2017 was we had limited OT time up to until 2 to 3 weeks for our closed distal radius fracture. So we explored the option of using WALANT technique to to do our surgery under local anesthesia. And this is also an option given to patients who are contraindicated for regional anesthesia or general anesthesia, such as patients with multiple comorbids. And so how do we improve this? This is that's why WALANT came into the picture. So for our lecture outline, I will introduce what is WALANT and how do I prepare my WALANT solution. And I will discuss and how long is our solution last for the duration of the surgery. And then we'll go into the WALANT for distal radius and the lesson learned. Full disclosure, we have a website. Our website is walant.surgery. It's free for everyone. You just need to be registered. And we make no money from this website. And this is a book by Donald Lalonde, which is our textbook for WALANT surgeries. And this is the co-founders, Don Lalonde and Eli Phillips, and also the other editors from all over the world practicing WALANT surgery in their own hospitals. So what is WALANT? WALANT stands for wide awake, local anesthesia, which we use lignocaine or lidocaine, and we don't use any tourniquet to secure the bleeding. You can read more about WALANT in this paper by Lalonde, Conceptual Origins, Current Practice and Views of Wide Awake Hand Surgery, published in 2017. And in this paper, there is a rapid worldwide adoption of this technique from all over the world, even in India by Raja Sabapati and Abkar Khan. So how do I prepare our WALANT solution? So we started off with our 100 mils of normal saline, and we took out 50 mils of that, and we put in 50 mils of lignocaine 2%. So in our sensor, we don't have 1% solution. So we use the lignocaine 2% and dilute it together with 50 mils of normal saline. And that will become 100 mils of lignocaine 2%, 1%. And to secure the hemostasis, we don't use any tourniquet, so we use adrenaline. So one in 1,000 and mix together all everything into this solution, it become one in 100,000. And to reduce the injection pain and have the prolonged lignocaine effect, we mix sodium bicarb in one in 10. So this is 100 mils. We put 10 mils, the whole ampule inside the solution that we have. So all this will become 111 mils of WALANT solution. And how much to give? In a normal patient, in a normal lignocaine 1%, the max dose that we can give is actually 4 mg/kg. But if we add adrenaline to the mix, we can give maximum dose of 7 mg/kg. So in a healthy 70 kg patient, the maximum is 70 times 7, we can give about 490 mg. And since 10 mg lignocaine is equivalent to 1 mil, a total of 49 mils of WALANT solution can be given in a 70 kg patient. And how long does it last? A paper done by my teachers actually, Prof. Jamari Safwan and Prof. Shalima Abdullah, they did a study on randomized control trial of trigger finger release under WALANT and without adrenaline. So they compared between the lignocaine plus adrenaline and without adrenaline. They found out that if without adrenaline, the average time that can last is about 2 hours. But if you add adrenaline into the mixture, it can last about 6.86 hours. So about 6 to 7 hours. Let's go direct to our topic now, distal radius fracture. How do I inject my solution? So there is two things that you need to give, which is the subcutaneous injection, and second is the periosteal injection. So for the first subcutaneous injection, I will give at the incision site. So this is the normal modified Henry's approach on the FCR. 10 mils of solution will be given on underneath the skin here at number one. Number two will be at the proximal aspect, deep to the periosteum. Three at the middle aspect and distal aspect for the fourth. So for the periosteal injection, we need to give, for me, normally I will give at the most superficial part of the bone, which is our lateral aspect. So this is where we give the first 2 mils directly on the bone at the lateral aspect. Then we walk the bone and give it at the volar and also distal aspect, about 4 mils each. So this will cover proximally, circumferentially around the bone. Then we give middle part of the bone and then distally. So this will cover surrounding the whole distal radius. This is a video showing our injection technique. Using the 27 gauge needle, and this video is speed up 8 times. So this is where we inject at the periosteum. As you notice, initially I give 2 mils first at the lateral aspect. Then I walk the bone at the dorsal and volar. So this will cover the distal radius. But in some patients who is who have big hands, so you might have to give more at the dorsal distal radial anal junction. So we give at the dorsal aspect here about 10 mils there. And for those who have concurrent ulnar styloid fracture, even though you're not planning to fix it, you just give it there, because when you do manipulation to reduce the fracture, patient might have pain if you don't give coverage there. So this is just to numb the ulnar styloid if you have a fracture there. If you don't have, don't bother to give it there. So this is the distribution. The blue is actually where the subcutaneous layer are, and the red dots here are the incision site. The pink are the periosteal coverage after giving the denuding. So as you can see here in one of our cases, we show that there is a clear surgical field here, and that's the fracture site. And this is without using tourniquet. So even without using tourniquet, it doesn't disturb your surgical field. And this is our patient also showing that before and after, showing the bloodless surgical field again, patient's moving freely without any pain. All right. This is after reduction, showing clearly the plate is there without any bleeding. And the patient is smiling happy during the surgery. And another thing to note, that there is also no intraoperative swelling during closure. Good reduction there. So we published our surgical technique in Journal of Hand Surgery in 2018. And since then, there are a few other surgeons have published their own technique on doing plating distal radius under wide awake technique. And our series were just published in October 2020, WALANT distal radius versus general anesthesia. So this is under Global Online, so it's freely available to read. This is another case that we did, a 70 plus year old lady who is with multiple comorbids and dependent on wheelchair. So she insisted that she doesn't want any general anesthesia to be given. She wanted to go back immediately after surgery. She don't want to be admitted, and she don't want any cast. So the only option for her is obviously this plating under wide awake surgery.
Okay, now auntie, can you move your hand, gerak tangan? Macam ni? Very good, tak sakit lah auntie? Ha. Semua kosong eh, very good kan? Tak sakit pusing macam ni? Bagus auntie, very good. Okay, thank you.
And this is her after 2 weeks of surgery.
Atas bawah. Very good.
Another lady here insisted on WALANT surgery because she had very bad post-op nausea and vomiting, and she doesn't want that again. So we did her under WALANT. Again, no bleeding, not much bleeding there. It's quite clear surgical field. And after 2 weeks, range of movement is nearly full. Finger extension, flexion, wrist extension and flexion are all good. So this is our friend, good friend Thomas Appart from France, who also practiced this technique in his hospital, and also Paul Sibley from America. Quite happy doing this because for those patients who has very bad comorbids, and this is an example of a patient who is on warfarin, and the pulmonologist expected her to be admitted to ICU for 2 days after general anesthesia, since he is practicing Walant surgery there. So he did this under Walant, and the patient was discharged on the same day itself. And this is Ruben Duquen from France, also doing distal radius under Walant. So this technique is actually, there are a few surgeons that successfully implemented this technique in their own practice. And then come COVID-19 in March 11, 2020. And this puts Walant surgery in the highlight, where British Orthopaedic Association have come up with a guideline where they aim for to perform all hand and wrist surgery under local anesthetic block or under Walant. So because of that, I was invited by Dr. Lalonde and Jeff Gelfand from Annapolis invited us to give a talk on our technique so they can start their own Walant service there in the hospital because the anesthetists are busy treating their COVID patients. So on April 7, we did a half an hour, it's supposed to be half an hour Zoom meeting, becomes about 3 hours where we shared our own techniques so they can redo it in their own center. And immediately after, maybe about 2-3 days after that, they had a case where they did their own distal radius under Walant. So this is a video showing his technique and his success case.
Good. Make yourself open and close your fingers. Good. Turn your palm up and palm down all the way down. Good. Move your wrist up and down. Any problems? Any pain?
No.
Okay, great.
Okay. Second case. It's quite a big segment, big fracture there.
There you go. Turn your forearm. Palm up, palm down. Take your hand all the way up. How are you feeling?
Feeling good.
Any problems or not?
No. I don't mess with you.
So, what are lessons learned? Walant can be applied for fracture fixation or other bony procedures. Walant is very useful, especially in this current pandemic. And bony Walant is easy to do as proved by Jeff Gelfand. After a Zoom meeting for 3 hours, they successfully implement this technique there in their own center. So before we, end my topic, I would like to share this radius and ulnar plating for a patient who had a bilateral hemothorax where they had to put a chest tube on him and he can't lie down on flat on the bed because of the he can't breathe well with that. So we had to do the surgery with him sitting down.
Okay, I'll go. Come on, we get home. Why can't we get home? Okay, it's not going to happen. Okay, I need to ask.
So he was comfortable throughout the surgery. And we did both the radius and ulnar plating for him.
Okay. So this.
Okay, thank you so much, everyone.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Anil Adham, for sharing your knowledge on Walant technique. Hope many of the delegates will start following this technique soon. I take this opportunity to thank Dr. Terrence and the organizing team of Journal of Hand and Microsurgery for this wonderful initiative. Kindly accept the digital memento on behalf of the organization. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Very nice.
We have a lot of questions from the panelists and the delegates, so we can take quick questions pertinent to all the 4 speakers.
Terrence, can I go ahead?
Please go ahead.
Thanks, Terrence. Dr. Jesse Jupiter, my question was, with the dorsal fragment there, we were still talking about screws. and with the clamp now, which you showed, is there any other alternative? Even the alternative which you showed as that compression screw system, which is common, still, as you said, the dorsal, the cortex is still thin there, and with the compression there, with this, the screw can still protrude later on. So are we looking at any other alternatives, like making that clamp cannulated kind of a thing and passing fiber wires or something like that to catch that dorsal fragment? Totally eliminate the screw itself. Yeah.
Haven't done that, but it's a very intriguing idea. Yes, you're right. To try to get the screw close to the cortex and then use the clamp, it's likely to push the screw through the cortex. It's just an adjunct to better reduction per se. It doesn't necessarily guarantee that the fragment will be stable in that position. And therefore, I think if your CAT scan shows a fairly large fragment, it's worth trying to at least support a screw in that way. And you can use the screw in an over drill position to try to get a little compression, as Dr. Chen showed with his plate.
Thank you.
So may I ask Dr. Jesse Jupiter, sir, regarding use of intraoperative CT scan, as the spine people sometimes are using that for particular screw. Is it a possibility in this radius also?
The CT scan?
Intraoperative.
I think when you talk to colleagues who say, I've done so many, I don't need a CT scan. I think the economics of the CT scan are become less and less a problem, and it certainly gives you better information, gives me better information preoperatively.
Thank you.
Unmute yourself, sir.
If a patient has a distal radial ulnar joint dislocation along with the comminuted distal radial fracture, how will you stabilize that in acute cases?
Well, actually, we just looked at a series of those where there's definitely a dislocation beyond just displacement of the fracture of the distal radial ulnar joint. And if you can get the sigmoid notch restored, what happens is the stability of the distal radial ulnar joint comes primarily from the contact pressure between the ulnar head and a sigmoid notch. And that's why if you want to test for stability after you've fixed the end of the radius, we often used to take the ulna and go up and down, but it will always go up and down more than the other side because the distal radial ulnar joint ligaments have been torn. But if you compress the ulna to the radius and then rotate after you've fixed the radius, if you'll see that it's almost always stable unless the distal band of the oblique ligament has been disrupted. So I think when you have this distal radial ulna dislocation and you can reduce the radius, it will almost always reduce the ulna unless there's an interposition of tendon or some other structure. Now, if you have a large styloid fracture in that setting of the ulna, it might be a good idea to fix that. But otherwise, it's the contact pressure that keeps it stable.
Okay, another question to Dr. Jupiter as well. If the distal ulna is too much comminuted and it's not fixable, and how will you deal that case? If it's too much comminution of distal ulna, very unstable distal radial fracture as well.
Well, it depends on the patient and the patient's activity level, but if it's not reconstructable, and an older patient who I suspect we would consider a Darrock with a tendon stabilization. I wouldn't personally put an implant in the setting of instability unless you had a total joint implant, which ordinarily you don't have when you're doing trauma.
Please go ahead, unmute yourselves.
This for Dr. Chen. I have two questions. when we reduce the distal radius, our reference points basically for the height and inclination would be we are looking at the DRUJ as such. Now, if you have the DRUJ convergence, what is your reference points for you to say that you've restored it at the end of the surgery?
Yeah, you're still looking at the you're still looking at the height and those traditional parameters. But you're also looking at the contour of that, the radial edge of the radius, and to see that that is relatively aligned with the radial shaft. If you see that line discontinuous, you have to study it and just make sure that that you've been able to restore that relationship. You'd like to see that the ulnar side is restored and the radial side is restored to give you a sense of whether the bones are together. You can over distract using a laminar spreader, so you have to be a little bit careful with that as well.
And my other question was, with your Zoom grade one plates now, you said you're following them up. Are you using an ultrasound or is it clinical examination? What is it for you to say that FPL is undergoing attrition? Is there any tenosynovitis or any early signs of impending ruptures? So what is the follow-up? How does it happen?
Yeah, at 6 months, I'll check the crepitus. I'll put my fingers on the FPL and have them, I'll check crepitus at that point. If I feel any crepitus, the plate comes out. I think that the lessons that I've learned from that are that you have to be more wary. The second issue around it is that with regards to ultrasound, Doretti Fufa has been looking at that and she at hospitals for special surgery using ultrasound. Her results are very interesting and you can get very good resolution with ultrasound. The question ultimately becomes, does that add anything to your clinical exam? If you're seeing if you feel frank crepitus, I think that's a pretty good threshold. And then the question is that, are there other gradations that you have to intervene on earlier?
May I make a point when we were talking about reduction and the height and alignment, what Margaret McQueen's group years ago looked at over 4,000 distal radius fractures treated non-surgically. And what they found was patients tolerated reasonably well malalignment as long as the intercarpal alignment between the lunate and capitate was within a reasonable sense of alignment. So what we see really in a lot of patients that have had trouble in motion or stiffness or even late arthritis is a carpal malalignment issue. And I think that's one way you might judge if you're treating somebody non-surgically, whether they're perfectly reduced in the volar tilt or not, 10 degrees, 20 degrees. It's really where the lunate sits in relationship to the capitate that will be the most important outcome measure. And that's what, it's interesting, that was defined a number of years ago, but in these studies that looked at non-op versus op, they failed to do that. And certainly that's why grip strength may be a relative valuable parameter.
And also I'd like to add to that, in addition, as you're doing your surgery, and this is what I learned from Jesse as a fellow, is that when you see that alignment and you've placed your volar plate and you see that the capital lunate radial axis is off, that's when you know you have to go to the back. That's when you know that you have to add that adjunctive fixation. So.
Thank you.
Okay, one question to all speaker. What is the role of K-wire, only K-wire, as a fixation in this era of plating?
Probably we can start with Boretto because Vijay is the one who is into intrafocal fracture reductions for dorsal radius fracture. So he categorically wants to know the role of intrafocal Kapanji wiring in distal radius, preferably dorsally displaced radius. So Boretto can start with
that. Yes. I think that is an option. In our hospital, there are so many years we don't use just intrafocal pinning. So with advantages of the volar locking plates or internal fixation, either dorsal or even volar, we don't use anymore that intrafocal fixation. But it's an option. You have to have a clear knowledge of the complication of intrafocal fixation and also of the instability you can have with intrafocal fixation. But I think that it rests as an option today.
Our partner Chai Mudgal. Go ahead, Jesse.
No, go ahead.
Our partner Chai Mudgal has done a number of patients using K wires, and his outcomes have been great. I think that what's important is that he selects the patients very carefully, and he has a lot of experience and an understanding who's going to do well and who you have to be more careful with using pinning. And so I think that. I think there can be a role, but the experience needs to be there. What were you going to say, Jesse? I'm sorry.
Oh, well, I think we need to understand why the volar plating for Collies type fractures became important. And that is, it's really when you're dealing with metaphyseal bone that's deficient, traditional methods, casting or even K-wires, were not as predictable, but even if they were working with X-fix or cast, and someone was older and it was their dominant limb and they lived alone, it was a big imposition. And what we saw when we treated those, as was shown in all these talks, with internal fixation, the person could become more independent. So really the lock plate was evolved for osteopenic bone in metaphyseal areas. We've expanded it quite a bit, but really you can do many 2 and 3 part articular fractures with K-wires very well. And it holds very well. But if you look at when we introduce X-fix, to stabilize that, it's not as easily tolerated by older patients, and it takes longer for them to regain their functional action and strength, but they do regain it as well. So that's what we've come to realize, why in certain groups that you can treat with one versus the other, as was Dr. Chen said of our partner, he selects the ones one way or another. And for the same fracture, he might put a volar plate because he needs that patient to be more independent early.
Yeah, I tend to agree with Dr. Jupiter. As shown on my patients before, there is the 70-year-old lady. She was moving her finger, her radius. After about 2 weeks, she's doing everything by herself. So early results are very, very good with volar plating.
Yeah, but if there's a logistic is the problem, then everywhere.
Yeah, we understand that, Vijay, you know, and economically, you know, less constrained, we do have problems. So we have on the panel Anirban and Tahir. Quick comments on that to the panelists so that we can wind up.
One question I had for
Anirban, can you repeat the question? We are not audible. Okay, we are not audible, so we will take questions from from Tahir.
Hello, my question is to Dr. Neal Chen regarding the technique that you have demonstrated. Was very nice technique. Either we can do a distal first technique or the proximal first technique regarding the locking plates. So what's your preference? What you do and how many percent of the patient you will do distal first and how many patient you will do a proximal first?
Yeah, so I'm doing more and more distal first. I would say right now I probably do about 80% of them distal first. If I have a volar, so if I have a volar Bartons, I'll do proximal first because it makes a lot more sense to get to place the plate down and then push everything up. So it also is dependent on the fracture. But if I can do the distal first, I will, because I feel like my reductions I'm more happy with my reductions because I can get the tilt better because I've locked it in with the plate. And then I can adjust for the radiolar convergence secondarily. So I don't have to worry about the plate placement as much.
Thank you. And how often do you do fragment specific fixation?
I do it occasionally. And it really is, I'm really looking at that volar ulnar corner fragment and seeing if I can get fixation on that corner. If I can't get fixation on that corner satisfactorily, then I will do fragment specific plating. I will say I probably do it less now than I did, you know, 4 years ago, 5 years ago, because of just the evolution of implants.
Thank you, Dr. Chen. We'll have one last question from Anirban. Sorry, again, we couldn't get you on the audio. Audio is not playing well. Could you type that so that we can ask the panelists? Before that, quick 30 seconds from all the speakers and then probably we'll end it. Quick 30 seconds. We'll start from Dr. Jesse. Closing remarks.
In summary, I think what we're seeing is that it's not a stagnant area of treatment. There's constant evolution. We're seeing evolution with anesthetic control. We see evolution of implant fixation, and we see evolution of better understanding of fracture patterns that you might do just as well with a secondary dorsal approach from verlar approach. So actually, many people thought, you know, hey, it's not much to these fractures, but in fact, there's quite a bit more than a simple Colles fracture.
Thank you, Dr. Jesse. Neal Chen, your quick 30 seconds closing remarks.
I think that, as Dr. Jupiter mentioned, it's in evolution, but and also I would add to that, our understanding continues to improve. And our understanding as it improves will begin to clarify many of these areas where we don't fully understand or have a clear vision of what's happening. So I look forward to our evolution over the next, you know, century.
Well said. Thank you. Thank you very much. Dr. Boretto, a quick closing comment.
Yes. Well, as you said already, distal radial fracture, we have to understand the principle of treatment of distal radial fracture. After understanding this principle, we have some different ways to achieve that principle. And evolution of implant and evolution of techniques, as Amir showed us, should should allow us to better treat our patients. That's the final concept. All the evolution should allow us to treat better our patients.
Thank you. Well said. Dr. Amir, your closing comments.
Yeah, I would like to answer a little bit of questions here in the Q&A section. So there's a one from what Sochit. What's the difference between WALANT and brachial plexus block? So one of the things that under WALANT is we reduce the bleeding by giving adrenaline without any tourniquet. While if you do a brachial plexus block, obviously you need tourniquet to reduce the bleeding. And second question by Talib Al-Harabi. In regards to WALANT, do you think this will aggravate the already swelling area? I don't think so, because we just want to numb the area. And like I said, how many meals total we can give is according to the patient's weight. Chantas was asking whether distal radius fracture during an amputation manner. It depends on the hospital. In our hospital, before this, it was done under hospital setting. It's not ambulatory, but with this, we can push it towards ambulatory case setting. Mohsin Ali, adrenaline affect the digit. I'm not worried about the digit so much because this is giving it at the wrist, so it doesn't really affect the digit. Is there any difference in WALANT setting for distal radius fixation obese patient? The only difference that I would like to add is actually to give local at the distal radioanal joint, because sometimes the solution given at the peripheral region from the radial styloid area doesn't go all the way to the distal radioanal joint. So that can cause pain if you don't numb the area. I think last one. Yeah, don't you have afraid to damage the sensitive nerve during WALANT injection? So again, if we give directly deep to the periosteum from the lateral aspect, the radial aspect, there is nothing there. There's no nerves, no arteries there. And you have to walk the bone slowly. Go to the dorsal and go to the volar, walk the bone. If the needle is always on top of the bone, you are safe. Thank you so much.
Thank you. We have to leave you here because we are short of time and we have very strict agenda that will finish in 1 hour. Probably we have extended it. We are extremely sorry for that. We could not take a lot of questions. We will be on time with all the programs. With a brief introduction, we have a lot of delegates from Iran, Iraq, Philippines. All those are giving us congratulations and wishes to all the speakers, panelists here. With quick 10 seconds, I'm just going to share the next program so that probably everybody will be aware of what's happening in the next month series. So we'll be happy to share that. We'll have our series of talk in the upcoming DRUJ and TFCC injury on the December 12th. Keep your calendars filled with it. With this, I'd like to thank all the speakers and the panelists who are here who made us exactly the day. This ladies is still evolving. We will have a lot more evaluation to come. Thank you, one and all. Good night. Have a safe day. Thank you. Bye bye.
You're welcome. Thank you so much.
Bye
bye.
Good night, everyone.
Thank you. Bye bye.
Thank you. Bye bye.
Bye bye.
Thank you. Bye bye.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.